She is the human rights director at GetUp. She leads the No Business in Abuse campaign, which targets corporate involvement in mandatory detention, and the Let Them Stay campaigns. Shen's background is as a human rights lawyer, and she's an advocate in Australia and right across Asia. Give it up for Shen.
Thanks, everybody. As Sally pointed out, my current area of work is in refugee and asylum seekers' rights generally in this country. And I thought the most useful thing that I could do is explain what that fight is like. And the way I characterise it is, working on this issue in this country, in our world at this time, is like fighting when your back is up against the wall. And what we usually do in that scenario, you can imagine a cartoon scenario where your back is against the wall and you've literally got nowhere else to go. People do two things. Our movement does two things. One, it looks at a line that it previously defended as a line of last resort and says that's our goal. That's the only place we can get to, and that's just there, 5 centimetres in front, is where we have to get to. The other thing that we do is just randomly pick up anything that looks like a stone and throw it wildly into the general area of the people that are coming at us and hope that it will somehow hit something. And what I want to talk to you about is how we fought when our back was against the wall. And look, it can sound a bit overblown, but let me tell you where it started 2 years ago, which was we had 3,000 people in offshore camps, imprisoned without trial, without timeline, in conditions that were horrific, in circumstances that we now know to be a crime against humanity. Not only did we have that, but it was publicly popular, wildly popular. And it seemed like every time something came out about how bad that situation was, or somebody said it's an international crime, it just became more popular. And not only was it popular, it was political orthodoxy. It was a bipartisan political policy that we were going to do this in this country. So both major parties, most of the population. And then of course, we had corporations and even a few NGOs making an absolute mozzer out of the thing. Billions and billions of dollars in taxpayer funds were propping up, were manning, in most cases, the guard, the gates, were keeping people inside these centres, were giving them the actual requirements to keep these things going. And so in that scenario, our back was against the wall. And so what were we doing? Well, it was tempting just to look at this overall thing and do the stone throwing. It was tempting to look at it and say, well, a minimal goal might be to get people to Malaysia. But what we decided to do at that time, across the room, and a whole bunch of people, was sit down and think about this scenario and look at it like a system, acknowledge that it's interconnected, acknowledge that it's interreliant, and think of it, excuse me here, but think of it like a chair. Think of it as a regime with three key legs under it, a little stool, public opinion, political consensus, and corporate involvement. And what we thought is, all we can do is just kick the leg out of the chair, one at a time. I just kick that leg. So we started No Business Abuse. We didn't attempt to change public opinion. We didn't attempt to contact any politicians. We just looked at that corporate leg of the chair and said, I'm just gonna kick that. And 2 years ago, 15 companies had tendered for a 5-year contract to run these offshore detention centres in circumstances that would have cemented them into the future. And now, in just a few months, the last of those corporations is exiting the detention centres and there's literally no one else left to run them. We asked ourselves the question, is it possible to change public opinion? How would we do it? And we made a commitment to those 267 people that that national campaign worked on behalf of. And we said to ourselves, I have to acknowledge that as somebody who's been in the refugee rights movement, I must take responsibility for the absolute propeller of public opinion. That was also me. I have to take responsibility. So in doing that, and say what I also have to do is say that I will do what works, not what I would like to see. And we ran a public campaign that absolutely targeted itself at the so-called Israeli audience and moved public opinion 15 percentage points in 9 weeks. And the 267 people that were supposed to be on planes, most of them are now here in the community. And then an election happened and the chair just basically doubled in size. And this is what it's called when you find your back is against the wall. And then across the movement we said, right, let's try bring them here. Let's try attacking that core political consensus, that core thing that holds the whole thing up about people should never come to this country under these circumstances, both political parties. And the pressure got so big from across the movement that Malcolm Turnbull announced his US deal. So previously these people were supposed to go home and end up in Malaysia were now supposedly suddenly going to go to the US. And interestingly, one of the best moments of all of this was when the Migration Act changes were proposed. And it was again another moment where we just expected the ALP to fall into line. It was what had happened previously. It was the notion, and what was put forward by Minister Dutton at the time was, we want legislative barriers to these people ever coming here. And it failed. The attempt to break the bipartisan consensus, incredibly work that took place across the movement, both inside and outside of the doors of Parliament, worked. But I still want to say, I woke up this morning to the Daily Telegraph front page that said, refugee to jihadist. This is still fighting with your back against the wall. Those sentences are still there, and many people are still there. But what are the three things that I've learned from this movement? And the first is strategy. The number of things, that old John West adage, it's the fish that you don't see, or whatever it is, something about John West and fish. Basically the fish that you don't see are the big people. Basically, I should remember that before I even say it. You basically know. But the important thing is, in that sense, it's what you don't see. It's not picking up every single stone and picking it widely at anything that moves. It's about what you don't pick up as well. Are we going to go to Daily Telegraph on this front page? Not yet, not now. It's about trying to make strategic decisions and not bloody panicking. But the second thing that I learned really, really critically, and I want to tell you about the three phone calls that I made. During that Thursday, I'll tell you about the first and the second, but the second phone call that I made was to the anti-deportation cohort across the country. The radical left activists that many in the refugee sector have derided, continue to deride as not having a place. I rang them and I said, we've got 267 people, we're going to run a massive campaign, we most likely will lose, and if we do, will you be there to stop those planes? And they said yes. The second phone call was to the union movement, or the third is America. I said, I know that this has brought your movement apart, but we stand there, and they were always there, and they did. And they literally held up a hospital, laid us in the Japanese hospital in Brisbane, and prevented the removal of the outbreak. And the third phone call was to the churches. I know you have stuck there at every moment, you've visited detention centres, you've been doing that activism. Will you answer the call? And the nuns and the priests and everybody across the faith movement said yes. And hundreds of churches joined the sanctuary movement. And the lessons from that is that despite any differences that we all may have, of which we do, and that's fine, we cannot do this alone. You have to unbrand things. You have to leave spaces open for everybody in the movement. You have to do those calls and ask humbly for assistance. Because without that, we are nothing. And the third thing that I learned And the first call we made in every single scenario was to people who were living this experience. Before we launched Open Stay, we went and met those 267 people, and in whispered conversations, we went through the strategy. We literally drew a map of Australian public opinion. We went through an archive of scenarios with words that work. We outlined the strategy and said, does this make sense? Where do you think it should shift? And we got consent and strategic input and involvement of people affected. And as a movement, critically looking at this room now, we have to shift who's in our room. We have to shift who's at the table doing strategy, or we cannot win. From working people to ableism to women to everything, people with lived experience are the experts, and we have to get them in the room or we will not win. And so finally, where does that leave us today? And I think this is the thing about being an activist at this point. You have to find hope, you have to find strategy, and you have to find working together. Because where we have to go, we know what we have to do, it's just that it seems exhausting. Speaking about race and racism in the face of Trump and Hansen is exhausting. Speaking about people's humanity in situations where the Daily Telegraph is blaring what it's blaring, and Andrew Bolt is on Twitter, and, you know, the Prime Minister is doing what he's doing is exhausting. But be strategic, don't let it panic, and let's work together.
Does your microphone work?
It does.
Oh, good. Thank you, Shen. That's a great story of really resilience of the movement and of the campaign, but also about toughness when your back's against the wall. I often reflect on the 2007 election and sense of hope that I'm sure you had and I had and lots of others had at that particular time, thinking that those dark days of how we treated asylum seekers were now behind us and that things were only going to get better from here on. And I guess maybe a fundamental, you know, mistake about history, things don't always get better. What mistakes do you think we made after 2007, and how do you think we can avoid them in the future?
Yeah. I think there's one critical thing, which was there was a lack of alternative forward. And we thought that breaking out one leg of the chair, which at that time seemed to be the bipartisan political consensus, the fact that the ALP had shifted on this, was enough. We didn't see it as a regime. We didn't see that we needed to bed down something else, because the kind of resilience of that regime resurrected itself. And it is something I do worry about. And we do have plans around it. Lots of people in the movement have plans. We can't let that happen again. Before we leave this space, if we ever get there, we win, which I think we will in the next 18 months, we have to bed down an alternative. And that means really frank discussions across the sector and across the movement with refugees and asylum seekers. Because just think about this, about what didn't happen. People were dying at sea. What's the obvious thing to do when you've got a dangerous passage? You give people an option outside that passage. And, you know, I think it was Palmer that put that forward. Oh, well, why don't you just fly people over? And the movement didn't have the courage to put that forward, and to some degree still doesn't. And I think that has to be sorted out, because otherwise, and the regime has to be rebuilt with something else. Otherwise, it'll come back. It's like a zombie movie.
Temporary migrant labour, Islamophobia, refugees are all hot button issues that, in a way, the LNP would say, break the glass if they get into trouble, break the glass and let's press one of these issues, and automatically Labor feels as though there's got to be no distance between them, especially in the circumstance, I guess, now when the LNP don't have anything else going for them. What can we do, or should we try and do something about the fact that these are hot button issues? Can we turn those buttons off or not?
I think we can and we have to. Because I think if you look at it with both a race and an economic analysis, they're completely interconnected. So when John Howard stopped the Tanbar, what he did was the most incredible bait and switch on the Australian population. He basically pretended that he was stopping immigration, especially immigration of the other. And what he did instead was oversee the biggest change in Australia's migration program, where he ripped it open and took it from one of permanent migration to hundreds of thousands of exploited temporary migrants that are now holding up our economy, working for below minimum wage for corporations across the country. And what he succeeded in doing was obfuscating all of that with this garbage about people arriving on boats. And because we looked at it just from the perspective of race and human rights, we failed to see that. So the solution, part of taking down the zombie, has to be talking about what kind of vision you have as a nation, what are the policies that take that down, what does liberation look like for all of us, the people in the abattoir in regional Australia who are temporary workers, who are exploited migrant workers, and the people next to them who are seeing their wages undercut by greedy businesses. It is intimately connected, and we can't do one without the other. So what we're going to look forward to doing is starting a policy and a messaging discourse across the progressive movement about what that should look like, because we have to name it, and we have to name it in the next 18 months. No pressure.
Okay, thank you very much.